Hey, what's going on, SAT preppers? This is Brian with Radical Prep. Today I'm going through the College Board practice test number one for the new SAT that's coming out in March 2016. I'm going to time myself, so I'm going to give myself 25 minutes. There's no calculator on this section, and we'll see if I can do it in 25 minutes while trying to give you guys tips and so I can keep the pacing and show you how I would do this on test day. All right, so let me start my timer here. 3, 2, 1, begin the test. Okay, question number one. If x minus 1 divided by 3 equals k, and k equals 3, what is the value of x? So you can kind of do this two ways. Some people might just set it up and cross multiply. Another way to do it, so you're going to set this whole thing equal to 3. You could think to yourself, well, what divided by 3 gives you 3? That means the top part has got to be 9, right? So how do I get 9 in the top here? Well, that just means x has to equal 10. 10 minus 1 is 9. So another way to do that one. Remember, we're trying to get through this fast because we got to save time for the questions at the end. Number two. For I equals radical negative 1, what is the sum of these two expressions right here? And one thing I'll tell you, just looking at this right away, 7 plus 3i plus negative 8 plus 9i. There's too many parentheses. We don't need the parentheses. So if you rewrote this, 7 plus 3i plus times a negative, that's minus 8 plus 9i, and we're just going to combine. 7 and negative 8 is negative 1, and 3i and 9i is 12i. So negative 1 plus 12i. Done. Move on. Okay. Number three, on Saturday afternoon, Armand sent M text messages each hour for 5 hours, and Tyrone sent P text messages each hour for 4 hours. You know what? Let me write those down. Armand sent M text messages for 5 hours. So he sent 5M, and Tyrone sent P text messages for 4 hours. That's 4P. You can see where this is going, probably, or hopefully. Which of the following represents the total number of messages sent by these two guys? Well, hopefully you put that together. It's just 5M and 4P. 5M and 4P. Number three. So we're going to try and blast through these early ones because there shouldn't really be any tricks with them. They should be pretty much straightforward. Number four. All right, here we go. Long one. Kathy is a repair technician for a phone company. Each week she receives a batch of phones that need repairs. The number of phones that she has left to fix at the end of each day can be estimated with the equation P equals 108 minus 23D, where P is the number of phones left. All right, I'm starting to get to that point. You know when you start reading and you're starting to get confused? P is the number of phones left, and D is the number of days she has worked in the week. What is the meaning of the value of 108? All right, so we said D is days worked. Pretty much if she works 0 days, she's going to have 108 phones to fix, right? And as the week goes on, she's going to have less and less phones to fix. So I'm guessing, not really guessing, 108, it's a number that stands by itself. So it's going to probably be the amount of phones she has to fix when she's not worked any days, or how many phones she starts off with. Kathy will complete the repair within 108 days. So we don't know that. Kathy starts each week with 108 phones. That's a good one. Kathy repairs phones at a rate of 108. Well, it's got 108 in there, but there's no rate here. The number stands by itself, so there's no rate that goes with it. Kathy repairs phones at a rate of 108 per day. Well, no, the 108 is by itself. This one with the D has a rate, right? 108 does not have a rate. Well, that rhymes. 108, no rate. Okay. So you got to pick something like B. She has 108 phones to fix because if she works 0 days, she's still got phones to fix. So that's how much she starts off with. All right. Number five. We have got, that was number four? Yeah, it was. Okay. Number five. All right, so now we got a messy one here. Which of the following is equivalent to the expression above? All right, so it looks like this is another situation where they want you to distribute this negative sign into everything, and they want to test if you know how to do that correctly. So let me rewrite it, even though on test day I might not, because it's a kind of a lot of work and I would just do it in my head. But you know, you never know, and you could always make a mistake. So negative times negative is positive x squared y. Negative times a positive is a negative 3xy squared. And negative times a negative is a positive 3y squared. So let's start combining terms. X squared y, there's 2x squared y's, which is nice. Let's get rid of the ones that don't have that. Let's look at the xy squared, because that's the next thing in our answers. 5xy squared minus 3xy squared is 2xy squared. And that's this one, choice C. We're not even going to do more work because we're already happy we got the answer. All right, got to move on. Got to make time here. A pediatrician uses the model above to estimate the height of a boy in inches in terms of the boy's age. Ugh. A pediatrician uses the model above to estimate the height H of a boy in inches, heights in inches, in terms of the boy's age A in years, between the ages of 2 and 5. Sometimes I read these things and I get confused. Based on the model, which is the estimated increase in inches of a boy's height each year? So the question is, how much is the boy growing each year? Well, honestly, my instincts just tell me to pick A and move on, because this number by itself is not changing any year. So you're going to have 28.6, and each year it's going to grow 3, 6, 9, 12. It's going to grow in increments of 3. That's what this number means. It's your rate that's going up. But let's say you didn't believe me, and I'll waste time on this the way maybe someone would on a test. So H equals, let's say when he's 2 years old, right? When A is 2, age 2 years old, plus 28.6. We got 6 plus 28.6, and we got 34.6. All right, so now, the kid's getting older. Now he's 3 years old. We're still adding 28.6, right? So now it's 9 plus 28.6. What do we get there? That's 37.6? Yeah. So we went from here to here. Every year, how much taller is he getting? Because the height's in inches. We've got a net of 3. So you can do the work to get the right answer, but if you kind of know that the 28.6 is never changing anything, you're going up by a factor of 3 every year, choice A. All right, so we lost a little time explaining. That's all right. Let's make it up. Let's go. Oh, God. Number 7. What the heck is this? All right. The formula above. Okay. The formula above gives the monthly payment M needed to pay off a loan of P dollars at R percent annual interest over N months. Which of the following get... Okay, here we go. Which of the following gives P in terms of M, R, and N? So you want P by itself. How do you do that? All right, so let's take a simple example so I can teach you something. What if I said M equals 1/3 P? Well, if you want to get rid of the 1/3, wouldn't you multiply both sides by 3/1? You just do the reciprocal, right? 3/1. That's a simple example, but that gets rid of all the junk next to the P. You're going to do the same thing for this really complicated example, and I'm not going to write it out because I don't have time, and you're not going to do that on the SAT. But what do we notice here? On this side, or on the screen side on the right, you flipped it. So you're going to do that. Where's my pen? You're going to do that here. You need to multiply by the reciprocal. So what does that mean? That means that this ugly expression has to be on the top. It's got to be in an answer choice that's on the top. Well, which one is that? What do you know? It's on the top. I'm not even going to check the other information, because if it's not on the top, I don't care. It's not on the top. And choice D, which I'll scroll down to real quick, that's not even on the top either. All right. So you're looking, like I said, let me go back here and line it up. You're looking for the answer that puts that stuff on the top. So you got to flip it. So I'm not even doing a lot of work here. It's more understanding what you're looking for. I hope that makes sense to you guys, because you can't sit here all day on this test and write everything out. Choice B. Okay. Let's clear it. Let's make up time here. I'm on question 8. And it says I got, this is why you want a good phone on test day. It says I got 15 minutes left. All right, we got to hurry up. Okay, A over B is 2. A over B equals 2. How about I read the question? What is the value of 4B over A? So again, this is another one. They flipped it, right? So let's flip it. B over A, we're going to flip it. That's really 2/1. This is going to be 1/2. So that's 4 times B over A, which we said is 1 over 2, your answer is 2. Half of 4 is 2. Okay, number 9. So that's how we make up time. What is the solution to the system of equations above? And it looks like we got a system here. First thing I'm going to do, I'm going to fix this bottom one. I like doing addition and substitution with systems of equations to solve them. So I'm going to reverse the order here. And that's, so our two equations are going to be 3x plus 4y negative 23. And then I fix the order on the bottom one. Negative x plus 2y equals negative 19. So now, it'd be nice if this x had a 3 in front of it. So I'm going to multiply the entire equation, everything by 3. And let me write the top piece again, even though it's going to waste some time. But you guys will get the idea. 3 times negative x is negative 3x. 3 times 2 is 6y. 3 times negative 19 is negative 9, 18, 27, negative 57. Okay. So now, how do I get rid of these two equations? I'm going to add them. Why do I do that? I'll put the plus sign here. 3x plus negative 3x, gone. 4y plus 6y, 10y. Negative 23 plus negative 57, 10, 7, negative 80. Okay. Divide by 10, divide by 10. Y equals negative 8. The only one that has a Y of negative 8 is choice B. So we actually got lucky. We didn't have to do a lot of work. If you found Y to be negative 6, or you did it a different way, you might get two answer choices. So we got lucky with that one. That's nice. All right, number 10. For the function G defined above, A is a constant, and G of 4 equals 8. What is the value of G of negative 4? And the equation is on the top there. We have G of X equals AX squared plus 24. The problem is we have two variables, one there, one there. But they do give us this information here, so let's plug it in and see what happens. This means that's my X value, right? That's X, and that's my Y value. That's the result, or the output. What happens when I plug in that X? So that means that 8 is going to equal, we don't know what A is, but our x value is 4. 4 squared plus 24. I'm going to bust it here because we're really probably close on time. All right, minus 24, minus 24. So we get negative 16 equals 16a. And we divide both sides by 16, and we get a equals negative 1. Okay, that's good information. Sorry, that's equals. A equals negative 1. Now we can put that in. So let's update our equation. G of x equals negative 1, or negative x squared, plus 24. Now what does it want to know? What is the value? Now we're up to the last part. G of negative 4. That means plug in negative 4 there. I want G of negative 4, right? So that's going to be, I'll just do it down here, negative 4 squared plus 24. Okay? So that's going to be negative 4 squared is 16 plus 24. And our answer is 8. Choice A. We're done. Move on. We got to get going here. This test is, it's brutal. 25 minutes for 20 questions. Not a lot of time for, messing up, getting stuff wrong, taking too much time.